regret, my charming Elise? Do you grow melancholy after the kind assurances you gave me of my love? Tell me, do you regret having made me happy?
No, Valere, I could not repent anything I do for you. But to tell the truth, our success gives me some disquiet, and I'm quite afraid of loving you a little more than I ought.
Elise, what is there to fear in this kindness you show me?
Alas, a thousand things at once. The rage of my father, the reproach of my family, the censure of the world. But more importantly, dear Valere, the change of your heart.
Ah, you do me wrong. Suspect me of anything, dear Elise, rather than the failure of my devotion to you.
All people talk in the same strains, Valere. It is only their actions that prove them to be different.
Then at least wait to judge of my heart by mine. Allow me time to convince you by a thousand proofs of the sincerity of my affection.
Alas, how easily we are persuaded by those we love. Yes, Valere, I do believe you really love me, and will be constant with me. I shall not doubt it. I shall only fear the blame which others might put on me.
But why this uneasiness?
I should have nothing to fear if the whole world looked on you as I do. My heart pleads all your merits, supported by that gratitude by which heaven has bound me to you. I call to mind at every moment the great danger you took when you risked your life to snatch mine from the fury of the waves. That tender concern which you showed when you dragged me out of that water. That ardent love which makes you neglect country, family, and which makes you pretend to be a servant to my father. All this moves me deeply, and is sufficient in my eyes to justify our love. But it is not perhaps sufficient for others, and I'm afraid they will not understand our love.
Of all that you've mentioned to me, it's only by my love that I pretend any merit to you. As for your scruples, your father takes but too much care to justify you to all the world. His excessive avarice and the austere ways in which he treats you would justify stranger things than our secret love. Forgive me, charming Elise, for speaking of him in this manner before you. You know that on the subject one can say nothing good. But if I can find my father, mother, and sister again, we shall have no trouble winning them to our side. I'm impatiently expecting some news of them, and if it does not come soon, I myself will go in search of them.
Do not go, Valere, I entreat you. Think instead only how to work yourself into my father's favor.
You see how I go about it? And the artful deception I was forced to make use of to gain into his service? Under a mask of sympathy and of sentiments, I disguise myself to please him.
But then why not try to gain support from my brother in case the Mistress Claude should take it into her head to betray us?
There's no managing them both at once. Their tempers are so opposed that it's difficult to be friendly to them both at the same time. But you, for your part, take advantage of the love between you to win him to our interests. Here he comes. I'll step aside.
I don't know if I have the power to lay myself thus open to him.
Very glad to find you alone, sister. I'm impatient to tell you a secret.
Here I am, brother, ready to listen. What is it you have to say to me?
A world of things, sister. Summed up in one word, I'm in love.
You are in love?
Yes, in love. And I know that I can depend on a father, and that the name of son subjects me to his will. That we ought not to engage ourselves without the consent of those who gave us birth. That heaven has made him guardians of our vows. That the heat of youth very often leads us towards dangerous precipices. That, say all this to you, sister, to save you the trouble saying it to me. For frankly, my love will listen to no one, and I beg you not to dissuade me.
Have you engaged yourself, brother, to her you love?
No, but I'm determined to do it, and I ask you once more to offer no objections.
Am I, brother, so heartless a person?
No, sister, but you're not in love. You're ignorant to the sweet violence which passion wreaks upon our hearts. I'm afraid of your wisdom.
Alas, say nothing of my wisdom. There is no one who does not feel in at least. And if I lay my heart thus open to you, I'm afraid you will see I am much less wiser than I appear to be.
Sister, if only your heart like mine.
Let us finish your affair first. Tell me with whom you are in love.
A charming creature who recently took lodgings in the neighborhood. Her name is Mary Ann. She lives with her mother, whom almost is always ill, and who she cares for tenderly, comforts her. Ah, sister, if you could but see her.
I see a great deal, brother, in what you say.
I found out that they're quite poor. Imagine, sister, what a joy it will be to raise the fortunes of the one I love. Then imagine how through the avarice of a father, I'm unable to show her any of this joy or give her any proof of my love.
Well, I see what your concern must be.
Can anything be more cruel than this? This close-fisted rule that we're kept under? The strange modulariness in which we're made to starve? What good is it to have means if we don't get them so we're too old to enjoy them? Or if means I'm forced to run myself in debt with everybody around me? At least I wanted to speak to you, to stand out father on this matter. If he opposes me, I'm determined to elope with this girl and make the best of it. I'm saving money wherever I can. If your affairs are like mine, and father opposes us both, we'll leave him and rid ourselves of this avaricious tyranny.
It is true that every day he gives us more reason to regret the death of our dear mother.
You better not be wasting any of the food that I'm preparing. Anything you eat comes out of your wages.
Oh, I hear his voice. Let us finish our talk in the garden. Afterwards, we'll join forces and attack him together.
Get out of here, quick, and let's have no more prattle. March out of my house, you sworn rascal, you gallows bird.
Never have I seen anyone so villainous as this cursed old fellow.
Are you muttering at me?
Why are you driving me out?
It well becomes you, scoundrel, to ask me reasons indeed.
But what
have I... Get out of here quick before I beat out your brains.
But what have I done to you?
You've done this. You made me resolve to get rid of you.
My master, your son has given me orders to wait for him.
Go wait for him in the street, then. Not in my house, planted bold upright like a stake. A spy everlastingly before my eyes. Nosing around in every corner to see if there's something to steal.
But how the deuce can anyone steal anything from you? Are you the man to be robbed, who stands guard day and night and keeps everything under lock and key?
I'll stand guard as I please and lock up everything I see fit. I tremble for fear that he suspected something about my money. Don't you go up making stories that I have money hidden in my house.
You have money hidden?
What? No, you rascal. I just wish you wouldn't maliciously spread the report that I had.
What difference does it make to any of us as long as we don't get any of it?
Ho, become clever. I'll put some cleverness on your ears once more. Will you go?
Very well. I'm going.
Wait. Are you not taking something of mine with you?
You have nothing. What could I take?
Come here and let me look. Show me your hands. Show me your hands!
There.
The others?
The others?
Yes.
There.
Are you sure you have nothing crammed in there?
Look yourself.
These wide breeches are fine receivers of stolen goods.
How richly does a man like this deserve to get what he fears, and what joy it would bring me to rob him?
What?
What?
What are you saying?
I say you feel pretty well about to see if I have robbed you.
And that's exactly what I intend to do.
The plague take all stinginess and stingy curs.
What are you saying?
What do I say?
About stinginess and stingy curs?
Why, I say, the plague take all stinginess and stingy curs.
Who are these stingy curs?
Villains and curmudgeons.
Whom do you speak to when you say that?
Why, what are you so uneasy about?
I'll be uneasy about what I ought to be.
Did you think I was speaking of you?
I'll think what I think. Now tell me whom you speak to when you say that.
I speak to my cat.
And that's how I'll speak to the head that it fits.
Would you hinder me from cursing the covetous?
No, but I'll hinder you from being insolent. Will you hold your tongue?
I name nobody.
A word more and I'll break your bones.
The cat fits someone, let him claim it.
Once again, will you hold your tongue?
Yes. Against my will.
Once more, give me back what you've taken from me.
But I have taken nothing from you.
Truthfully?
Truthfully.
Goodbye then, and go to the devil.
Where does he think I've been?
There's a rascal of a valet. I don't like to have such a good-for-nothing cur about. In truth, there's nothing wrong with keeping a great sum of money near one. Happy is the man who puts out his cash at honest interest and keeps no more around him than he needs for his own purposes. One's not too surprised to find in the whole house a few safe hoarding places. I have no faith in safes because they're a mere bait for thieves. But yet, I don't know if I've done right in hiding over here the 10,000 crowns that were paid me yesterday. Oh, heavens, I've spoken aloud in front of them. What are you doing?
Nothing, Father.
How long have you been there?
We just this moment came in.
Did you overhear?
What?
What I was just now saying.
No.
You did.
I beg your pardon, Father, we did not.
I was simply saying how hard it is to keep money these days, and I was saying happy is the man who has 10,000 crowns in his house.
What reason do you need to say that for?
I'm very glad to tell you what I say, because I wouldn't want you to think that it was I who had 10,000 crowns.
We wouldn't think that, Father.
But if I did have 10,000 crowns...
It is my opinion that...
It would be a fine thing for me.
Father, these are things which do not concern us.
10,000 crowns.
I don't believe that...
Then I wouldn't have to complain as I do now.
What reason do you have to complain? The whole world knows you're wealthy.
What? I wealthy? Those who say it are liars and rascals.
Father, don't put yourself into a rage.
My own children have betrayed me and become my enemies.
Is it to say that you have wealth to become your enemy?
Yes! The way you two talk and the way you jaunt about town, it's going to be responsible someday for someone coming into my house to cut my throat under the impression that I'm stuffed with silver.
What great expenses do I have?
What great expenses do you have? The way you jaunt about town cries to heaven for vengeance. Taking you from top to bottom, one might find enough to buy an annuity for life. You must certainly rob me going dressed as you do.
How can I rob you if you have no money?
Well, then where do you get the money to afford all this?
Why, I buy gambling, for as you know, I'm very lucky and I lay most of my winnings on my back.
Ah, if you were smart, you'd set out your winnings at honest interest.
That's true, I suppose.
Besides, are all these ribbons necessary? And all these hooks and eyes to hold up your breeches?
You're right.
No more of this. Let's talk of other business. Mercy on me. I think they're trying to pick my pocket. What does all this secrecy mean?
We were just deciding which one of us was going to speak to you first. We each of us have something to say to you.
Ah, and I likewise have something to say to each of you.
It is about marriage, Father, that we wish to talk.
It is about marriage that I wish to talk to you.
Oh, Father.
What is it, the word, daughter, or the thing that frightens you?
Father, marriage might be frightening in both ways.
I assure you, I have nothing to be frightened of in what I decide. To begin at the beginning. Have you noticed a young girl named Marianne in the neighborhood?
Yes, Father.
And you, child?
I have heard her spoken of.
What do you think of this girl, son?
She's a charming creature.
Her beauty, her wit?
Most attractive.
Her air and manner?
Simply admirable.
Do you think that she has the makings of a fine housewife?
Yes, Father.
That a husband might live happy with her?
Without question.
That this would be a desirable match?
Oh, yes.
There is one trifling difficulty. I'm afraid she doesn't have as much money as one might want.
Oh, Father, money is no problem when it comes to marrying a virtuous girl.
I'm very glad you agree, for her excellent conduct and kindness have entirely won my heart. And I intend to marry her, provided she has some dowry.
What?
What?
You're going to...
To marry Marianne?
Who, you? You?
Yes, I. What does all this mean?
Dizziness has come over me all of a sudden.
Go quickly to the kitchen and get a glass of water. It'll soon be over. That's what I've decided on for myself. As for your brother, I'll give him a nice widow. And to you, I'll give to Monsieur Anselm.
To Monsieur Anselm?
Yes, a staid, prudent, wise man who's not more than 50 and is reported to be very well off.
But I have no desire to be married, Father. If you please.
And I do desire that my precious little girl be married, if you please.
I beg your pardon, Father.
No, I beg your pardon, daughter.
I am Monsieur Anselm's most humble servant, but with your leave, I will not marry him.
I am your most humble slave, but with my leave, you shall marry him this very night.
This very night?
This very night.
This cannot be, Father.
Oh, this must be, daughter.
Now I tell you,
yes, I tell you.
No.
Yes.
This is something you'll never force me to do.
This is something I will force you to do.
Well, rather than marry such a man, I'll kill myself.
Oh, you will not kill yourself. Just look at this. Whoever heard of a daughter speak to her father in this way?
Whoever heard of a father trying to marry off his daughter in this way?
I'll wager the whole world will agree with my decision.
And I'll wager that no reasonable person would.
Ah, here's Valère, my humble servant. Would you be willing to let him judge between us on this matter?
With all my heart.
So be it. Come here, Valere. We need you to decide who is in the right, my daughter or I.
Why, you, sir, without doubt.
Do you know what we're speaking of?
No, but you cannot be wrong. You're always right.
I was simply telling my daughter how I had found a nice man for her to marry, and the baggage tells me to my face she won't have him. What do you say to that?
What do I say to that?
Yes.
I...
Well, out with it.
Well, I say that in the main I'm of your opinion, you couldn't be anything but right. At the same time, she is not altogether wrong.
How could that be? Monsieur Anselm is a perfect match. He has no children left by his former marriage, and he's reported to be very well off. And furthermore, he has agreed to take her without a dowry.
Oh? Without a dowry?
Yes, without a dowry!
I won't say another word.
It's a considerable savings to me.
Most certainly. Of course, your daughter might say to you that marriage is a more important affair than people think. That means being happy or unhappy all one's life.
Without a dowry!
You're right. But there are people that might object that this great disparity of age, of humor, and of sentiments might make a marriage subject to most vexing accidents.
Without a dowry!
We're quite aware of that. Not but there are fathers who prefer to satisfy their daughters rather than sacrifice them to their own interests, who would...
Without a dowry!
It's true. Without a dowry. It stops all arguments.
Heavens! I hear a dog barking. Perhaps it's someone come to steal the money I have hidden in the garden. Don't stir. I'll return in an instant.
Are you joking, Valere, to speak to him as you do?
I do it so as not to make him suspicious and gain my end the better.
But this marriage, Valere?
We'll think of some way to break it off.
But how, if it's to take place tonight?
Just pretend to be ill.
But they'll discover my deception when they call a physician.
Nonsense. What does a physician know? You can act as ill as you please and they'll find some reason for it. In short, our last resort is flight, which will hide us from everyone. And if you're loved, your lease is sufficiently strong. Yes, it is fitting that a daughter should obey her father, and when the strong argument of without a dowry is presented, she should be ready to accept whatever husband is given her.
It was nothing, thank heavens. That was very admirably spoken, Valere.
Sir, ask if I speak too warmly in taking the liberty to speak to her as I do.
On the contrary, I agree with you completely, and I want to give you the same power over her that heaven has given me. No, no, don't object. I insist.
After this, resist my commands. Sir, follow her wherever she goes and give her more of the same lectures.
Very well. You'll oblige me.
I think I shall succeed nicely.
Do.
Yes, money is the most valuable thing in the world, and you ought to thank heaven for the worthy father it has bestowed on you.
Happy is the man who has a servant like him. I'm going to the kitchen to make sure they're not wasting any food.
Good day, Madame Elise. Good day, Monsieur Valere.
Yes, father. Here, rascal, where have you been? Didn't I order you to stay here?
Yes, sir, and I came here to wait for you, but your father drove me out in spite of myself, at the risk of being beaten.
How's our loan coming through? Things are more urgent than ever. Since you left, I found out that my father's my rival.
Your father? In love?
Yes, and I had a devil of a time concealing my feelings about it.
He dabble in love affairs? Is he trying to make a joke of them?
It must be a punishment for my sins.
But why do you keep your own love a secret from him?
To give him less suspicion. What did the money lender tell you?
To tell the truth, sir, those that borrow money are in a bad way. You must put up with strange things when passing through the hands of a money lender.
Won't the loan go through at all then?
Oh, on the contrary. Madam Simon, the agent recommended to us, tells me she has left no stone unturned to get you the money.
I shall have the 15,000 francs I want then.
Yes, under some trifling conditions which you'll have to accept if you want the money.
Did you get to speak to the money lender at all?
Oh, really, sir, business is not done that way. He takes even more pain to be anonymous than you do. Simon would by no means tell me his name, but he will meet you today in a house to be decided upon. I have no doubt but the name of your father, once he knows it, will make things very easy. Here are some clauses that he himself dictated to Simon, which must be shown to you before anything can be done.
Go ahead.
On conditions that the lender see all securities good, and that the borrower be of a wealthy family and of age, a bond shall be executed before a notary, which may be chosen by the lender.
Nothing can be said against that.
The lender, to be conscientious, will not charge the borrower more than 6.5%.
Ah, 6.5%. That's an honest man. Nothing can be said against that either.
That's true, but Since the lender has not sufficient money at hand and must borrow from another at the rate of 20%, it is only reasonable that the first borrower pay this as well.
The devil, that's more than 25%!
That's what I said. You'd better think it over.
Think over what? He has me at his mercy. I must agree to his terms.
That's exactly what I told him.
Is there anything else?
Yeah, it's just a short clause. Of the 15,000 francs required, the lender will not be able to pay in cash more than 12,000. The borrower, therefore, must take the other 3,000 out in household stuffs, trinkets, and furniture, of which are listed below at the lowest possible price.
What does this mean?
Listen to the inventory. First of all, one upright bed with hungry lace handsomely sewed upon an olive-colored cloth, with a counterpane the same, in good condition, lined with red and blue taffeta. Why, they're bringing the stuff already. The loan must be going through.
What does he want me to do with all this?
Oh, wait. Item. One set of tapestry hangings describing the amours of Gambard and Musset. Item. One large musket inlaid with mother of pearl. With the necessary equipment, of course.
I shall go mad.
Have patience. Item. One brick furnace. Very useful for those given to distilling. Bologna loop with all its strings, or with very few missing. Item, one picture frame. Very nice for inserting a picture and hanging upon the wall. Item, one large lizard skin, 3 feet and 1/2 long. Stuffed with hay, of course. A pretty curiosity for hanging at the ceiling of one's bedroom. The above being worth far more than the lender, in moderation, has charged for it.
Oh, a plague choke him for his moderation. He's a scoundrel and a cutthroat rascal. Who ever heard of such extortion? Yes, yet he has me at his mercy. You see what young men are reduced to by the cursed avarice of their fathers? Is there any wonder that we want them dead?
I must confess that yours would drive the calmest man in the world to despair. And I have no inclination to be hanged, but he would tempt me to rob him. And by robbing him, I believe I'd be doing something meritorious.
Give me the inventory. Let me read it over.
Yes, sir. It's a young man in want of money. He is forced to borrow and will agree to whatever you request.
Are you sure there's no risk in it, Mr. Simon? Do you know the name of the young man or his family?
No, I can't give you the details. It was only by chance that we met at all. He has given his address to the keeper of your warehouse. All I can tell you is that his family is rich, he has no mother, and will give assurance, if required, that his father will die before 8 months pass.
Oh, that's fine indeed.
What's the meaning of this? Our Madam Simon speaking to your father?
Oh, could he have found out who we are? Have you betrayed me?
Well, you were very hasty. Who told you this was the house? It was not I, sir, that gave them your name or your address.
What?
This is the gentleman who wishes to borrow the 15,000 francs. And here is the furniture. I don't understand.
So it's you, scoundrel, who would stoop to such extremes.
So it was you, father, who would stoop to such baseness.
To run headlong into these rascally borrowers.
To put yourself into such villainous usury.
Do you dare appear to me before this?
Do you dare to appear beyond the whole world?
Are you not ashamed of your crimes?
Are you not ashamed just to be yourself?
To squander scandalously the money your parents have amassed for you with the sweat of their brows. Be gone out of my sight. Be gone out of my sight.
Father, who do you think is the greater criminal? Who borrows money he really needs, or who steals money he has no use for?
Get out of here quick and don't torment me further.
Thank you.
He must have a large store furniture someplace.
It is you, my poor LaFleche.
And you, Frazine, what are you doing here?
What I do everywhere else. Playing matchmaker, making myself serviceable to others, and taking the best advantage of my small talents. You know, heaven has given me no other income than intrigue, and I must live by it.
Have you any business with the master of this house?
Yes, I'm handling a little affair for him, for which I expect a reward.
From him? You'll have to be awfully quick to extract anything from him.
There are certain services which have marvelous effects.
As you say. But you don't know Harpagon. Of all human creatures, he's the least human. Of all mortals, he's the hardest and most close-fisted. No service would arouse his gratitude to the extremity of loosening his fists. And to give is a word for which he has such an aversion. He'd never say, I give you good day, but I lend you good day.
But I have the art of milking men. I know how to get into their affections, to tickle their hearts, to find out just where they are most sensitive.
Useless. I defy you to melt the man we're speaking of where money is concerned. He loves it more than reputation, honor, and virtue. And the sight of someone who sets demands upon him throws him into convulsions, makes him, ooh. Did you hear that?
Ah, Mistress Claude! You better not break those glasses or they'll be coming out of your wages.
He's coming. I'm going.